Thank you for joining us today, Vikram. As we all know, the pandemic has changed the way we live our lives, and perhaps it's forever. And the problem is there's this uncertainty, this pervasive and persistent uncertainty about the future, which has people depressed, anxious, worried. So, and there are no real answers yet for a lot of questions that we have. Like, when will I get a vaccine against coronavirus disease? How effective will this vaccine be? If you're a young person, when will I go back to school? If you've had economic losses, when will I get my job back? Will I have to wear a mask all through my life? And these are questions that that are bothering people. It's causing a lot of stress, anxiety. So Vikram, my question to you is, what is the fallout of the pandemic likely to be on mental health? Has anyone measured it? I know there's no data from India, but globally, are there any indicators? Are we sitting on a ticking bomb?
So thanks a lot, Sanchita. First of all, I want to just say how glad I am that you're actually addressing this extremely important and often completely neglected and unspoken issue in the summit. So I think there is data. It's emerging from many countries, including there is some preliminary data emerging from India as well and from the region. For example, a large survey from Bangladesh involving more than 10,000 respondents. And they all speak to the same finding that you've observed. That is to say, a rise at the population level of the experience of depression and anxiety and all the different symptoms that are associated with depression and anxiety. But I'd caution into assuming that that automatically translates into a rise in mental illness. I think it's a bit early to really extend to that because, as you rightly pointed out, these extremely extraordinary uncertainties are affecting everyone's mental health. Whether these will translate into an increased tide of mental illness still remains to be seen, but there is always a risk that will happen.
So do you think that when things go back to normal, once we have a vaccine and things reopen again, so do you think people will get back to normal? Will the stress actually go down or will it persist?
You know, I think we all know that this particular pandemic and the, you know, the control strategies is really what's affected our mental health in tremendous ways, is disproportionately affected different sections of the community in different ways. For example, for those groups of the population whose employment prospects have been extinguished altogether, and there are already concerns that certain kinds of work will no longer even exist or will be greatly diminished in the post-pandemic era, I think the impacts are going to be far more serious because you can't suddenly reskill and retrain yourself to do something completely different. On the other hand, those who have been largely relying on a technology or digital-driven economy, for them, this future probably looks a lot brighter. So I do think it's going to be disproportionate. And unfortunately, existing inequalities that existed before the pandemic are likely to get even worsened thanks to the changes in our economy that we're going to see in the months and years ahead.
There's a very good study in Science, which was just published today, which talks about how people who are poorer are more likely to feel the impact. In fact, they said 1.5 to 3 times more likely to have anxiety and depression. And as you know, in India, we've had, you know, the whole migrant crisis and people have lost jobs and they're really vulnerable to mental health issues. So what can be done about that? How can we identify problems there? A lot of them haven't got their jobs back. A lot of them are still out of work. So what can really the government do on scale, at scale, at the public health level to support them?
Yes.
The article also offers some solutions, right?
Correct. You know, and I kind of mentored that article in Science that was published today, and I'm thank you for mentioning it. So I think what the key thing what the article does is this. You know, for a long time, people have observed an association between living in poverty and poor mental health, particularly depression and anxiety. What the article has done is reviewed evidence that points to causal mechanisms using randomized controlled trials, demonstrating the mechanism through which both poverty leads to depression and anxiety as well as vice versa. And so in doing so, we can see two different kinds of interventions that can help us break this vicious cycle. First, structural interventions that help reduce the impact of acute impoverishment, for example, on migrant workers. A good example of that would have been unconditional cash transfers, direct income support to those who have lost their employment, particularly the daily wage laborers of India who constitute the majority of our workforce. But second, also recognizing that when you develop a mental health problem like depression and anxiety, providing low intensity psychological interventions can actually enable you to recover quickly, to regain hope, to regain the cognitive capabilities to get back into the workforce. So you need to do both structural interventions as well as health interventions. And as you probably know, some of the work that I've been doing with Sangat, the NGO in India, has really been focusing on the latter.
But do you think we have enough skilled health workers who can identify problems early and offer that kind of counseling and support? Because as you know, I mean, there are more psychiatrists of Indian origin in the US than there are in India. So do we really have the capacity to offer that kind of support to millions of people who need it?
So this is a huge question, a huge barrier. You know, do we have enough mental health professionals in India? Well, we don't. Not only do we not have enough in number, but they're also very, very unevenly distributed. So they're mostly working in urban areas and in the private sector. But there's a flip question, which is, do you need mental health professionals to actually deliver all kinds of mental health care? And the answer is we don't. After more than a decade and a half of systematic work by Indian organizations and organizations in other parts of the developing world, we now know that with carefully designed training programs, frontline workers like an ashas, like an Anganwadi workers, can deliver very effective psychological and social interventions for a whole range of mental health problems. And today we are working with governments like in Madhya Pradesh to actually scale up, for example, a brief psychological treatment for depression by using digital technologies to help ashas learn how to deliver these treatments and then to actually master the delivery of the treatment through peer supervision. So Sanchita, I see the future in that direction. How can we scale up rapidly these brief evidence-based psychological interventions through our existing community workforce, not just the ashas, but also, for example, the community health officers in the health and wellness centers, Anganwadi workers, and a range of other providers?
You know, but the problem is that health systems across the world right now are focused on containing the pandemic and, you know, saving lives, as they rightly should be. But then this is being done at the expense of other illnesses. And so you have NCDs, including mental health, which are being neglected. So do we really have, I mean, do you see health systems actually training health workers to offer this kind of support quickly over, let's say, the next 3 to 6 months? Do you see that happening?
Unfortunately, that's not been the story. I think you really hit the nail on the head. You know, it's interesting. What we're seeing right now is a unique moment in how biomedical thinking has actually focused on a single disease and ignored everything else. In my mind, this has been a real disservice to the health systems approach that we should have always adopted. By focusing only on COVID-19 and ignoring the needs of any number of other health conditions, from maternal and child health to, as you say, cancer care, mental health care, and so on, we effectively ignore the needs of those people who already were suffering from these different conditions. And as a consequence, we now can see the dramatic increases in those disease morbidities and mortality. What we should have done right at the outset was to acknowledge that we cannot shut down our healthcare system. What we need to do is to expand its capabilities to manage COVID-19, but not at the expense of everything else. Now we have to rebuild all of those services that were stopped or curtailed because of COVID-19.
Mental health is anyway underdiagnosed in the country. And now with COVID, a lot of people who are diagnosed illnesses are not getting the treatment. So how can that be addressed?
Unfortunately, Sanchita, your line wasn't very clear. Could you repeat that question?
My question was that in a country like India, mental health issues are already underdiagnosed. So you have about 1 in 10 people with some form of clinical mental illness, but most of the time it's anxiety, but it's not diagnosed. So my question to you was, in times of COVID, how can we reach out to support people who have existing disease?
So the government definitely has been thinking about this even before the pandemic. And the good news, and this is really fresh off the press, is the National Health Systems Resource Center strategy for NCDs, the identification of NCDs early in the community using ASHAs for screening, has now added a screener for depression. This is brand new news. This is terrific, thanks to the leadership of the NHSRC. We now have a tool that ASHAs can use, which is a series of questions, 2 questions only, to detect potential cases of depression who can then be triaged to the Health and Wellness Center or the Primary Health Center for a more thorough assessment. twinned with the fact that we are also developing, as I said, scalable ways of training ASHAs to deliver psychological treatments for depression. With these two together, there is a real prospect that in the coming years, we can massively expand access to mental health care, particularly at least for depression and anxiety, and then using the same models extending to other mental health conditions as well.
So what are these two questions? I mean, what are the early signs of mental illness? No, it's a shortcut, right, people? You just let us know and we'll ask ourselves the question.
Sure. So the questions come from a well-standardized and validated tool called the Patient Health Questionnaire, which has 9 items on it. And the 2 questions that we have selected, which come from a large body of validation science, are questions asking about very low mood or depressed mood. And a second question asking about the loss of interest, which is a core feature of depression, the loss of interest in everyday activities, rewarding and pleasurable activities. Each question is rated on a 3-point Likert scale. And so if you get a score of 3 or more, the odds that you might have a depression are extremely high, but you do need to go for a diagnostic assessment. So at least what you're doing is first level screening. It's not a diagnosis, it's a first level screening, which then is used to motivate the person to go for a more thorough assessment at the health center.
Because that's also, again, a big challenge, isn't it? Because traditionally, we've associated mental health with hospitals where people are forcefully taken and admitted. So there's still stigma against mental disease. People don't voluntarily go to doctors. So again, are there ways that we can overcome these issues?
So, you know, you pointed to another very important question, which is the role of involuntary treatment, violence against people with mental illness and their incarceration in asylums as a source of stigma. So first of all, it's important to recognize that mental health problems are a very diverse group of health conditions. What we talked about a moment ago with the PHQ is about mood and anxiety disorders, which for most people in India, they do not associate as a mental illness. Because for most people, the association that people have with mental illness is the pagal. The person who is going to be carted away by the police, often tied up and taken off to a mental hospital that was built by the British. Most of our mental hospitals, by the way, were built by the British before 1947. And in those hospitals, until quite recently, the conditions of care were awful. It required the National Human Rights Commission to intervene to actually require a reformation of these hospitals to become more dignified. So I do think a lot of stigma comes from those hospitals. But the reformation of those hospitals has been a fantastic strategy to help destigmatize mental illness. The other thing that's happened also is people like you, the media, has been far more sensitive in reporting mental health problems. And I've noticed a sea change in the last decade where I've noticed that there's a lot more respect given to mental health issues. There's a much more dignified way in people with mental health problems have been identified and talked about. And so I think all of this represents a very positive change in terms of reducing stigma attached to mental health problems.
It's not very often that I hear positive things when it comes to, you know, dealing with mental health issues. But again, you know, when you talk about COVID and the pandemic, because of the lockdown and then now the social isolation, people are not interacting as much with neighbors, families, and, you know, you don't have your social support around you. So how does that affect different age groups? You know, because older persons are not online as much. So they still need the physical support, which they're not getting. And younger kids, again, children, school-going children, it's not just academic learning at school. You're also learning life skills. You're also learning how to interact. There's so many other things that you learn in school. So how will this impact? Because people are already talking about the COVID generation. And, you know, these kids are going to grow up and some of them have kind of missed out on a lot of skills that they would have got from peers.
Yeah, you know, again, you know, this is such an important question you've asked that, you know, I believe that what we've done is completely thrown our younger generation under the bus. We have failed to recognize that this disease, which actually has almost a zero risk for people under the age of 18, yet this demographic has had to pay the biggest price of all in order to safeguard the rest of the population. And I think you're absolutely right to point out, by pretending that schools are places where people go learn geography and history, we've forgotten that schools play far more fundamental functions for all children, particularly the poorest children in this country. For example, schools are often the only place where you get the main meal of the day. Schools are often the place where you get a range of other healthcare interventions. Schools are a place where you learn to play. This is a place where you shape your personality. And by thinking that we can just substitute the school with online learning, not only have we ignored these fundamental roles of schools, but we've also ignored the fact that more than 80% of our children live in households where they did not have access to good quality internet or a device. So we've also further worsened inequalities. I will tell you one thing, Sanchita. I pray that our country moves rapidly towards reopening schools. We can do that safely. We have the weather in this country to be able to run schools outdoors where we know the risk of transmission is very little. We need to do this quickly because otherwise, as you say, the cost on the generation of kids who have lost almost an entire year of their education is going to be monumental.
What is the impact on older persons, people over 65?
Yeah, well, this is also a very vulnerable group. But let's not forget, older persons also recognize that they're at risk. They're at a particular risk of the disease. So at least there is a sense that by actually isolating myself for a period of time, I am protecting myself from a disease that is potentially very deadly. For young people, there is
almost overbearing.
You know, most young people don't even know they had the sickness. So for them, it's even more difficult to understand, why am I having to pay the price? And actually, you asked me a question about evidence. I'll tell you what, there's already evidence emerging that young people's mental health has worsened enormously. Where data is coming, for example, from the US and Australia, we can already see dramatically increased rates of suicidal behavior and depression and anxiety. We don't have data from India as yet, but I'd be very surprised if we didn't see similar kinds of trends in this country as well.
I've started getting questions for the session. I've got a question where this person said pain and mental health are inseparable. Keeping that in mind, how would you define pain? I'm assuming pain and loss is what they're talking about.
Absolutely, you're completely right. And in fact, this is one of the major reasons why we're seeing a rise in substance use as well. And by substance use, I'm particularly talking about opioid and alcohol. These are substances, particularly opioids, that are used to actually dull pain, but not just physical pain, but also psychological pain. And these two kinds of pain experiences are deeply interconnected. This is why after the 2008 financial crisis in the US, there was a dramatic increase in opioid abuse and life expectancy of working age Americans. Well, this is the work that led to the Nobel Prize in Economics to Angus Deaton. They've written a terrific book called The Depths of Despair. So to answer your question, the word despair captures psychological pain, but the deaths were occurring due to opioid use that was being prescribed for what was seen as physical pain. These are inseparable qualities in our human experience.
So are you expecting to see a rise after 2020? I mean, like it happened after...
Luckily, in India, we still control the use of opioids. And so thankfully, I don't think we're going to see kind of a picture that we saw in the US. But in the US, there is an uptick of opioid overdoses already in the last 6 months. I think we're going to have to be extra careful in this country to make sure that those kinds of narcotic analgesics do not become widely used on the street, of course. We have to be very careful because there is a real risk of people being directed in that direction. Instead, what we need, Sanchita, is better mental health care and relief from the stressful economic implications of the pandemic. I want to repeat what we talked about earlier. We have the solutions. We know that cash transfers, either conditional or unconditional, and access to low-intensity mental health care can help break this vicious cycle between poverty and poor mental health. Let us implement this at scale.
Right. I have another question from Raghav, who wants to know, how does pressure and stress affect mental health?
Well, you know, stress is part of everyday life and it affects our mental health. And most times it's good, okay? Because if we didn't feel stress, for example, when there's an imminent exam or you have to prepare for an interview, well, then you won't actually have that extra level of arousal that you need in order to perform at your best. So let's not think stress is bad. What is really bad is when that stress becomes toxic. And by toxic, we mean when it is pervasive, when it goes on for an extended period of time, and when there is no escape or relief from that stress. That is when your mental health starts suffering adversely and you develop a mental illness.
But that's what's happening now. So what would your tips to people be? How do you deal with
that? All right, okay. Well, my tips to you are a few things. First of all, acknowledge your mental health in the same way that you acknowledge your physical health. Imagine if you had a sudden acute pain in your chest, you wouldn't just sit around saying, oh, well, that's all right. No, you would immediately acknowledge it. And the next thing you do is do something about it. So for mental health, when you sense that there's something unusual happening that you don't recognize as part of your good mental health, talk to someone about it, because that alone can be a very, very powerful therapeutic procedure. It can help you feel a lot better immediately. Many people find benefit from distraction, particularly by getting engaged with activities, physical or otherwise, that you find enjoyable, listening to music, going for a walk. Meditation helps a lot of people, and there's a good physiological reason for this. There's no particular school of meditation, but any kind of meditation, from prayer to mindfulness to yoga, all of these are very helpful. And finally, I don't think you should ever feel embarrassed to seek help. There has never been an easier time than now to seek help from counselors and professionals, thanks to telemedicine. You know, you can sit in your home without any fear, without any stigma attached to going to a mental health clinic, and access mental health professionals directly through any number of the large number of opportunities for telemedicine that are currently available.
I have a question from Sonia, who wants to know, what do you think is the future for global mental health? Where is it headed?
Well, I think
movement, a dip, what?
Well, first of all, I think, you know, the pandemic has been a historic opportunity to actually make mental health much more on the spotlight. If you think about it, if you leave aside the virus itself, the second most frequently trending topic, which is health related, is actually mental health. And this is
really?
A
I didn't know that. That's interesting.
Yeah, absolutely. It's about depression, anxiety, stress, impact on children. If you take the full range of different mental health related topics, it's the second most trending after the virus. That is to say, issues like vaccines and so on. So I think this is a historic opportunity, and we must grasp it. It's a real opportunity to address the most neglected health issue of all. So within global mental health, one of the most important lessons I want to really stress is to move away from binary biomedical models of mental health. It isn't the case that your mental health is mental disease or mental disorder or mental illness. It's actually about a dimension of human experience, and each and every one of us is somewhere on that dimension at every point in our lives. And what we need to do is to normalize conversations about mental health so that we can do things in our daily lives to promote our mental health and well-being, to prevent mental health problems by becoming more adept at managing stressors, and when we develop a mental illness, to be able to access mental health care quickly and in an affordable way.
I have a question from Pooja, who wants to know, how would you describe the state of mental health in India? You know, Doc, it's interesting because you kind of divide your time between India and the United States, and I wanted to basically ask you, how have things changed? Have you seen a change in India, like in the last 10 years? You talked about a change in media and other things, but do you think people are actually talking about mental health issues more now than they were a decade ago?
Oh yeah, absolutely they are. You know, Sanjita,
are you seeking more help?
Yeah, well, yes, definitely. The numbers are increasing. You know, absolutely in every single metric, there has been a change. There's more demand for mental health care, and the government is acknowledging that there's a need to actually invest more in mental health. You know, 10 or 15 years ago, if I went to a government department and said I'm working in mental health, seriously, all they say, go to the Department of Psychiatry or go to the mental hospital. That is what mental health is for the government. Today, there are now active policy imperatives to actually skill up the ASHA and the community health officer and the Health and Wellness Center for Mental Health. This would have been unthinkable 10 years ago. So I think there's a huge, huge sea change. But of course, the real challenge is, resources. What we really need to see is these conversations translating into actual resources, and then for that money to be invested in the best science. And that science is the science of the implementation of mental health care using community resources rather than only relying on mental health professionals.
Since you're talking about this, you just launched the Lancet Country Commission for India half an hour ago, right? And there you're going to be talking about reimagined healthcare delivery in India to ensure universal health coverage. So what will the mental health component be? Because that's something that's going to reach everyone.
Absolutely. And you're right. This is very exciting. We've just launched this journey earlier today. So our aim is to produce a report for a roadmap to realize universal healthcare by the time India celebrates its 75th year of independence on August 15th, 2022. And the word universal is crucial here. Universal doesn't only mean all the people of India enjoy the same quality of care regardless of their ability to pay for it. But universal also means all kinds of health conditions, both mental and physical health. Since I'm involved with the commission, as you can imagine, we have explicitly stated this in our announcement, and also not just treatment, but also actions that serve to promote and prevent health problems from occurring. So, you know, mental health is absolutely bang in the middle alongside other health conditions within the umbrella of universal health coverage.
And you're also focusing on people participation. Why is that? Why do you think it's so important when it comes to mental health care services?
I think it relates to what you asked me earlier. You know, what is the change on the ground? The change on the ground is when there is demand. You know, we live in a democracy, and, you know, it would be fair to say that when people demand certain things, then it is more likely that the government will respond. I mean, consider the farmers' protests right now. Health has always been a very low on the agenda of people's demands. People have almost ceased to expect anything from the state when it comes to health. And what we want to do, therefore, is not just have a bunch of experts sitting and deciding things, but instead actually create a social movement. And to do that, we have to consult citizens, we have to engage them, we have to identify what are their aspirations, what are their priorities, so that ultimately, health is not just a biomedical issue, it isn't just a technical issue, but it is a citizens' movement to demand and expect quality care where the government acts as a steward, but may not necessarily be only providing healthcare.
It's interesting that you just mentioned the farmer protests. So I have a question from Zara, who says, what are your thoughts on farmer suicides in India?
Yeah, I think this is obviously a question that is of relevance. You know, farmers, first of all, to say, are a high-risk group in all countries of the world, not just in India. And this is because farming is a very, very stressful profession, because all over the world, farmers have to be exposed to vulnerabilities to the climate, to the fact that, you know, food prices change constantly and there's a huge amount of fluctuation. Farmers are also high-risk group because they have access, easy access to lethal means of suicide. In America, for example, guns are the leading cause of death amongst farmers. In India, it's pesticides. So I do think there's an importance here, again, of going back to earlier conversation. We need policies that are both buffering and protecting farmers from these uncertainties, but also we need to destigmatize mental health care for farmers. Farmers tend to be very stoical, and we do need to let farmers understand that mental health problems are common in this community, and seeking care is not associated with any shame.
And weakness, because again, that's a huge issue, because seeking help is seen as a weakness. I have a question from Akriti, who wants to know that, again, she refers to students who are studying from home and staying home for months. So she says, what is your advice on them? Advice to them? To help them deal with mental health issues.
So, the most important thing for these students to understand is their risk of infection is extremely small. What they really have to do is protect themselves for protecting the elders that they live with. And so get out of the house. Outdoors is very safe. There is very, very, very low risk of transmission outdoors. We live in a country where being outdoors, one of the great blessings of living in India, for most parts of this country, even in the winter, getting outdoor in the daytime is completely okay. It's not freezing cold, and it is also safe. Wear a mask when you're outdoors in a crowded situation, but otherwise, just get into meeting your friends, keeping physical distance, playing sports, etc. This is the best way to really promote your mental and your physical health. And of course, for the policymakers in our country, let's get our kids back into school as soon as possible.
Do you see that happening? Because you've been talking to policymakers.
Yeah, it's already happening. You know, in many parts of the country, it's already happening. It's quite perverse in some parts of the country. Part of the country I live in for when I'm in India is Goa. You know, casinos open before schools, and, you know, it baffles the imagination about how you can possibly even do that. And obviously, this is also where public mistrust grows. People begin to read into these sorts of decisions and say, well, what's the sense here? And obviously, their view is that not wrongly so, that there are vested interests that are determining public health policies rather than genuine public health concerns.
I have a question from Neha, who's a pain researcher. She wants to know, how do we begin to address disparities between people? Because that's what makes you vulnerable.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, you know, this is a structural question. You know, this is about how we envision a society, how we envision India. You know, one of the things that worries me the most is that India is not only a country that has the largest number of absolutely poor people in the world, that is, who live below a certain arbitrary threshold of income, but it is also one of the most unequal countries in the world. And in fact, inequality has increased dramatically in the last two decades. In fact, it has increased so much that today, a handful of Indians control more than 50% of our overall economy. This is obscene. And the only way we can address this kind of inequality, which goes at the, it's a poison, I believe, to the fabric of society, is to actually have government policies that are proactively redistributing wealth in a fair way.
So do you see it happening again, that you see government taking public health, mental health issues seriously enough to address these inequalities?
I don't immediately see anything on the anvil, unfortunately, no. I think, but we are going to need it, Sanchita, because, you know, the US and India are very similar. They're both deeply unequal countries, yet they're countries that have sufficient resources to actually correct those inequalities. Both countries are unequal, both have very poor health indicators relative to where they are. You know, the US has got the worst health indicators amongst the wealthy countries. India has amongst the worst health indicators for a middle income country. And I believe in both countries, they share a common problem, which is inequality. And unless we address inequality through policy actions, I don't see necessarily a good future for either country in terms of health.
So do you think one of the issues is also that services are not available for mental health? Because health-seeking behavior improves only when you get the service, right? If a person knows that they go to a primary health center and there's no doctor or health worker there, they're not likely to seek help. So do you think all that is changing now with Ayushman Bharat, with you know, with these health and wellness centers that the government has changed? Have you actually seen a change in the last 5 years to a decade?
Well, it's early days, you know, for the health and wellness centers. They've been rolled out only in the last year, and then of course COVID has taken away most of that last year.
So
I think it's too early for us to, you know, to cast judgment on this. What I will say is that they have the right will. You know, they certainly have the right aspiration, the right will, the documentation, the program documents are impeccable. There's been a huge amount of consultative exercise in engaging with diverse communities, including, for example, myself. I have also served on the planning of the programs for the mental health component of Ayushman Bharat. So I believe that they've really done everything. Now, as COVID begins to lift, thank God, let us pray and hope that there will be the right investments made to skilling up mental health care and indeed NCD care more generally through the public sector.
So Doc, we are out of that time, thank you. But as we end, what are your three tips as we open up after COVID, once we have a vaccine and schools open and businesses open, what are the kind of precautions people should take to protect
themselves? Those of you who have the means, like I do, think about the people who have lost jobs and who you were responsible for earlier. Try and find ways to recreate employment for everyone who used to work with you. Secondly, always maintain hope, because I think whatever happens, we will return to a society where there will be no epidemic, but there will be future epidemics. And let us learn the key lessons. And again, the key lessons here are that we must care for each other. And we must, those of us, again, who have resources, above all, it falls upon us to make sure that the poor in our country don't go hungry, dispossessed, homeless at times like this.
I'm so glad you brought up hope, and it's a great way to end the session. Thank you so much for joining us, Dr. Patel. Thanks.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.